graduate students in different faculties. But for all of you, the theoretical paradigm of nationalism is crucial. Am I right? Am I right or wrong? The theoretical paradigm of nationalism is crucial. Because you see, in the linguistic formations and the language question certainly revolves around the theoretical paradigm of nationalism. When the Indian nation was formed with the modern constitutional structure, and of course, the constitution was written by Baba Saheb Ambedkar. In this country, that was an accident. Also, it was an historical context. Now, as Bangia rightly explained to you, there was a colonial context, colonial background. But I'm not going into that. When the Indian nation under the constitution was formulated, by then, how to work out the federal structure of India was debated in a big way. Whether we should have a unitary state or we should have a federal state like United States of America, where the states would have significant amount of power with them, even to tell the sector that yes, I would like to go out of the nation and form a different state for myself. Now several options were debated. Finally, in the greater wisdom of America, supported by the rest of the Constituent Assembly members, mainly the drafting, having significant powers with them, and the center would also have certain powers with regard to the national issue. Now, it was in this context, there was a long-standing debate about how to form states once the Constitution comes in place. Now, almost from 1936 onwards, there was this whole national debate within the regions as well as in the Indian National Congress and elsewhere, that once the power is transferred to Indian people, the states must be formulated on the principles of linguistic state formation. Language will be the central question. Now, more than anybody else, it was Ambedkar who went on studying this whole question of linguistic states. Now, from 1936 to 1953, that was the year, in a big way, the question of forming Andhra Pradesh linguistic state began. At different levels of his writings, he went on opposing formation of linguistic states on the ground that a linguistic state would become a big state, number one, which would not be an administratively viable state. But the major argument of his to oppose linguistic states was that India was a country of caste for 3,000 years, and the immediate agenda of the liberated India was to destroy caste system. Please listen carefully. Dismantling of caste system was a central principle for opposing formation of linguistic states. Now, he started his argument in 1936 and he finalized his argument by opposing after Potisri Ramu's death. And when Nehru, who was also opposed to forming of linguistic states, came around, by then Gandhi died, and Nehru came around, agreed to form the linguistic state of Andhra Pradesh. And Ambedkar wrote a major theoretical article in Times of India on 24th September 1953. In that he said that in all linguistic states which are bound to be big in size, the minority castes are going to suffer enormously. And what does that minority mean? The minority castes for him were the scheduled castes and pre-scheduled tribes. He did not include OBCs. If he were to include OBCs, that would have become majority. See, this whole formulation of mind, what will the minority communities benefit in a big linguistic state? Will they get elected to legislature itself? No. Will they get administrative power? He said no. Will they get educational power? He said no. Then while referring to the support of Nehru to formation of Andhra Pradesh linguistic state, at that time they did not name it. At one stage they thought of putting it as Telugu Nadu. And there was maybe there were no linguistics around Telangana, because the word Telangana seems to have come from Telungu. In some of the rural Telangana districts, Telugu is called Telungu. Whereas the Andhra Telugu in the villages is called Telugu, but in the upper caste it was Andhra Bhasha. In all the texts it was Andhra. For Telugu. Among the people it was Telugu. In Telangana it was Telungu. Because of the mix of Urdu, it became Telingi. Turkolu, you know, the Turks. Turks became Turkolu. Because that was the question of Turkistan. So all those who were Turk-based, Turk-linguistic-based, Turk-culture-based, became Turkolu. Similarly, it became Telangana by some extent. So they could have had a Telugu Nadu or Telugu state, but they were forming Andhra Pradesh. So Ambedkar opposes to say, if Andhra Pradesh is formed simply because Potisri Ramulu died, He went on hunger strike and died. I have no sympathy for those who go on hunger strike and die. And I told the other day, those students who were sitting on indefinite hunger strike. Even our own students also bring some Dalits, some OBCs, some tribals and make them sit on hunger strike. I keep telling them that your parents starve for 3,000 years, don't starve now and die. Let the Reddis, Velamas, Brahmins sit on hunger strike and die. See this. So this Potisri Ramulu was a Baniya guy. Happily, you know, he should die. Not worry about. They had a lot of food. So he died. But Ambedkar did not mention about it. He says, if Andhra Pradesh as a linguistic state is born, the Reddis, Kammas and Kapus will dominate the state. Because they have the land power, they have the administrative power, they have the educational power too. Now then he says, in small states, the minority castes are likely to come into some of these positions. It was only a futuristic vision. It was in 1953, mind you. Now this kind of a lecture I am making for the first time on Telangana Krishna. Now, he opposed the big states and linguistic states. Linguistic states were bound to be big. If only Hindi linguistic state was formed, it would have been a country by itself. And that's the reason why the tradition was not falling. But by all means, given the language structures of even South, linguistic states were bound to be big, except Kerala, which was a strip. Now, he said the small states were important for what? Now, I will go for a derivative explanation. His understanding was that in the free India, in the federal democracy, the highest priority of his administrative position, he was a law minister.